Thank you everyone for coming. We're going to start shortly. What I'd like to do is to tell you briefly about the philosophy department and some of the majors and minors that we offer, some of the course offerings. A lot of you are in an ethics course, or some of you are in healthcare ethics. The talk this evening is a very nice bridge between our philosophy of justice minor and our healthcare ethics minor. So if this is of something, if this is of any potential interest to you, please don't hesitate to speak with me and let me know that you are interested in this stuff, and I can point you in a direction that might allow you the opportunity to pursue this further. But without any further ado, I want to introduce to you Professor Sharipa Tekin. She is with us here from Damon College in Buffalo. She received her PhD from York University in Toronto. She's got plenty of journal publications. Suffice it to say that there's lots of them, so I won't tell you where they are. There's plenty of them in there. But she is the co-author of a book with MIT Press called Extraordinary Science and Psychiatry. She's also the co-editor of the Oxford Handbook of Psychotherapy Ethics with Oxford University Press, obviously. So please join me in welcoming Professor Tekin.
Thank you so much to Dr. Riddle and Dr. Fleming for inviting me, and I'm really excited that I have a large group of interested students, and I'm always excited to kind of use these experiences, practical, real things in life that happen that are so common and ubiquitous, to kind of use them as opportunities to philosophically reflect on our experiences, and tonight's talk is going to be about one of them. So, try these experiments on individuals, actually that they need to have the same group of people. So if we have a diagnosis of depression, we must show that our clinical subjects all have depression so we can actually see if this particular drug helps or not. So it's a very important tool for research as well. But it's also very important for various administrative and insurance purposes. So you might get some disability benefits if you have a kind of untreatable depression. Your medication or clinical psychotherapy expenses may or may not be covered depending on whether your condition is listed in the DSM. It's also used for education purposes. So are there any psychology majors here? Right. So in psychology classes, in medical school, in psychiatric residencies, this manual is used to teach students how exactly psychopathology or mental disorder is. And it's also used in law context. So whether or not somebody is competent enough to stand trial is dependent on dependent on the criteria, whether or not they meet a certain criteria in this book. So in short, this is an extremely powerful book. It has all these purposes as it is indicated in the introduction of the DSM. So today I will talk about grief or bereavement, because grief, which we will talk about in a minute, is something that all humans, in fact animals also experience, yet it can become something like a mental disorder when a person's grief lasts longer than expected and when it's really, really hard to deal with by a person's own resources. So in this topic, grief has been a very important topic for clinicians and psychiatrists, and there has been a lot of debates on whether or not something like grief-related distress should be called a mental disorder, or is it better off just that we don't classify it as an illness? So I will talk about that and how grief can be a medical concern as opposed to just a kind of problem in living or life concern. And how discussions of grief took place in the evolution of the DSM over the years. You know, remember, we are making the diagnostic criteria better with each publication so that we improve our understanding of mental disorder, and grief has been part of these discussions over this period of time. And then I will talk about this recent change in the last edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorder, which kind of left the doors open to diagnosing people who are experiencing complicated grief with depression. So there's now an equation of grief-related distress and depression, and I'm concerned about that for reasons that I will discuss in my last section from a justice perspective in medical ethics. So let's first talk about bereavement. So, the kind of dictionary definition of bereavement or grief is that it's a condition that of being, having been deprived of something or someone, and it mostly applies to cases of death. So when we're talking about these clinicians and psychiatrists, and when I'm talking about grief, I'm referring particularly to grief that occurs after someone, some loved person or individual person dies. You know, we might experience grief if we move to another country, or if we move away to another city, we don't have any friends, but this doesn't apply to those kinds of cases. This involves death. So what was interesting was in the when grief becomes long and it's hard to deal with, and the person is having difficulty resume their life, come back to their life, maybe like 2 years pass after a loved one died, but the person is still not themselves. At that point, it becomes like complicated grief. So psychiatrists, clinicians, having patients in front of them who are suffering from depression-like thing following the death of their loved ones, wanted to kind of have room in the manual for grief so that if someone is having this kind of complex response, that they have ability to treat them. Because remember, in order to get insurance or in order to get some kind of treatment, you need a diagnosis. And they wanted to make sure that people with complex grief or complicated grief will also be able to get the treatment that they need. So the challenge was to distinguish depression from grief, because you don't want to just diagnose a grieving person with depression, because their grief has this very external, robust reason that maybe is justified, or maybe we sometimes think that it's not normal if someone is not breathing, right? Well, it should all come back to you later, so cry. That's what, you know, we tell people who are not really dealing with death well. So to kind of meet all of these goals, this is what the creators of the DSM-IV, fourth edition did, like this is the edition before the last one. They said, here are depression symptoms, right? Like you have to have either depressed mood or loss of interest or pleasure in daily activities. So you have to have one of those. And the four other symptoms have to be one of the, you know, weight change, insomnia, psychomotor agitation, feelings of worthlessness, and so on. So if you have this combination for about 2 weeks, if you go with these complaints to a clinician, they will be able to diagnose you with depression. However, right, remember, we don't want to just diagnose people breathing with depression. There is this clause that says, unless these experiences are being had because somebody is breathing. Does that make sense? So if somebody is grieving and have these symptoms, then you can't give them the depression diagnosis. Okay, so what happened in the fifth revision of the DSM is they got rid of this exclusion criteria, implying that someone who is grieving, you know, after a significant death of a loved one and experiencing these symptoms could be diagnosed as early as 2 weeks with depression when we don't have that criteria. And the justification was something like this. Look, this manual is a practical guide, and we want to be able to help these people who are really suffering because of their grief. And they said, there is no scientific evidence for characterizing grief-related distress and depression as distinct conditions because they have the same symptoms. So whatever treatment helps depression will also help, you know, people overcome grief. That was the justification. So this meant that, you know, these two conditions are on a par, and that they must be treated the same. So most of this change, this proposed change, faced a lot of criticisms coming from psychologists and clinicians and individuals who are grieving, saying you can't diagnose grief as depression. Grief is a normal response, and we have to have grief, but when you diagnose it as depression, you're kind of ruling out that normalcy of that experience. But the response was, well, you know, we want to be able to help these people, and these conditions are not really different. So what I want to do today is, I don't want to deal with the question of whether, you know, depression is exactly the same as complicated grief, right? What are the resemblances or differences? What I want to do is to kind of use this as an opportunity to look at the manual that we have at hand and to see whether or not that manual, even if we actually assume that grief and depression related grief, complicated grief and depression symptoms are similar, does that actually really help people who are grieving? Even if we assume that they're the same conditions, I'm going to be arguing diagnosing or classifying grief as depression is not going to necessarily help the patient who is grieving, and that you must be worried about this from a distributive justice principle. Okay? How's it going? Are you bored yet? No, you're laughing. Good. At least you're not asleep. So, okay, what are the criticisms? I'm going to give an example from an anthropologist who's written a lot on psychiatry. He says, who happened to have lost his wife recently, he is now responding to this change in the DSM-5. He says, in March 2011, my wife died and experienced the physiology of grief. I felt greatly sad and yearned for her. I didn't sleep well. When I returned to a now empty house, I became agitated. I also felt fatigued and had difficulty concentrating on my academic work. My weight declined owing to a newly indifferent appetite. This dark experience lightened over the months so that the feelings became much less acute by around 6 months. But after 46 years of marriage, I know that a lot of you are not 46. Luckily, I am not either. But think about 46 years of marriage, having been married to someone. That's a long time. He says, it will come as no surprise to most people that as I approach the first anniversary of my loss, I still feel sadness at times and harbor the sense that a part of me is gone forever. I'm not even sure my caregiving for my wife, who died of Alzheimer's disease, ended with her death. I'm still caring for our memories. Is there anything wrong or pathological with that? So this is the kind of challenges that the change in the DSM faced with. So let's first start, now forget about the DSM for a minute and think about what actually grief is. So have you ever lost a pet? Have you lost someone that you love? Do you know people who lost someone that they love? Right? This is a very ambiguous experience. It happens to a lot of us, even actually some animals experience grief. We can kind of sort of talk about that in, we can say that by looking at their behavior. So it comes in varieties in animal and humankind. And you know, similarly, some people are able to cope with it more effectively and successfully by relying on their own resources. Some people turn to their relatives and friends or spiritual readers or pastors. They deal with it that way. But some might experience what is called complicated grief. So complicated grief is when the grief lasts a long time. There's no time stamp on it, by the way. We'll talk about it just being long. And severe emotions and trouble accepting the loss and resuming life. So that's when things get kind of challenging. And complicated grief, when it was longer and hard for the person to assume starting their own life, it kind of started concerning medical practitioners. Have you heard of Montaigne? Yes. Okay, so he was writing about grief and after the loss of his best friend back in the 16th century. And he talks about it in a way that kind of still tells us, of course you have to grieve. There's nothing abnormal with that. So he says, what shame or limit should there be to grieve for one so dear? How wretched I am, having lost such a brother. With you died all joys which your sweet love fostered when you were alive. You, brother, have destroyed my happiness by your death. My soul is buried with you. Because of your loss, I have chased all my thoughts from my mind and all pleasures from my soul. Now, Montaigne is a writer, so he's actually trying to cope with this grief, with this loss, by writing, through writing. So when we then kind of look at an experience like Montaigne's or experience like Arthur Kleinman, there is one aspect of the grief is about the other person. So you might think that, well, that person could not complete the life that they worked so hard for. If someone dies before they finish college, we say, well, they had a loss of life plans and so on. So they had an unlived life. That's part of our sadness, that we feel really sad that this person could not complete their life. And another aspect might be, if your partner dies and you have these routines and things that you do together, after losing them, you just miss that person. You miss spending time with them. You might avoid places or situations that remind you your deceased. Famously, Sigmund Freud, how many of you heard of Freud? Okay, good. A psychoanalyst, who's a kind of founder of psychoanalysis, thinks very complexly about the psychopathology and mental illness. There are also things that I disagree with Freud, but I think he put this really, really aptly. He says, grieving individuals have to reclaim the energy invested in the deceased, right? My partner recently lost his grandmother, and his grandfather and grandmother have been married for 60 years. And they had lunch every Tuesday at the from this Italian spaghetti place, and now the grandfather is completely lost. He doesn't really know what to do on those Tuesdays for lunch, because that's part of it, that you need to kind of reinvest the energy, reinvent yourself after the other person is lost. So, and that's the other aspect. So when someone that you love dies, part of you also dies in a way, because if you lose your father, you lose also the identity of being a daughter or a son, right? Because that person is no longer there. Do you know William James? Also a famous psychologist who kind of defines the self. This is one of my favorite definitions of the self. He says a person's self includes not only his body and his psychic powers, but his wife and children, his ancestors and friends, and if they dwindle and die away, he feels cast out. So this is a very great and interesting description of what the self is. It's not just an individual, it's not just about you, but we're talking about yourself. Yourself also includes your family members, your loved ones, and if something happens with you, even your house and a horse or whatever you might own, and if something happens to them, you feel like a part of you is lost. And similarly, that one aspect of grief is actually losing yourself as the other person kind of drifts away from your life. And finally, another aspect of grief is, you know, loss of that relationship. So if that relationship that you had with the person who passed was supportive and loving, you might have difficulty finding, you know, other family members as like loving and supportive. In fact, there's some research that shows that adolescents who lose a parent that they are really close to have difficulty actually getting closer to their other family members when they die, because they battle their primary person to go to, and so on. Or, you know, in a lot of cases, a woman might be abused by her husband, and if the husband dies, there's like the kind of the grief process gets really complicated, because on the one hand, you lose a loved one, but that relationship had been abusive, and so on, so you have to kind of grieve that aspect of the relationship as well. It further complicates grief. And due to all of these reasons, grief had become, or at least complicated grief, had become a medical concern. So, and complicated grief is primarily marked by the pattern of persistency and elevated stress following a loss. So, and again, for us to consider something as complicated grief or long-lasting grief, we need to have an understanding of what the norms of grieving are. So, in a place like Turkey, you're supposed to grieve for 40 days. And if your husband dies, you're a widow, you have to wear black for about a year or two. And it's not really looked nice. It doesn't really look nice if you get married to someone and so on. So I'm talking about like more kind of rural areas in Turkey and so on. But it depends on the culture. So it might be kind of, you might have 40 days in that context, but if you're maybe in North America, you have to get back to work, and in my place of work, I think we have about 2 weeks. We can kind of miss 3 days unannounced, and we have about 2 weeks to get back to work after a significant loss. And that only involves first degree relatives and so on. So again, depending on the culture, the norms of normal grief might be different. And this kind of variation is an obstacle to distinguishing complicated grief from normal grief. So that's what clinicians try to understand. They wanted to really distinguish, understand when does normal grief period end and when does abnormal grief or complicated grief begins. Okay, are you still with me? Okay, so this scientist, this is a clinician and psychiatrist at Washington University in St. Louis. This is back in 1968. She actually did one of the most influential longitudinal studies on the normal time of grief. Normal time of grief. What is a longitudinal study? Yes.
Like it occurs over time.
Right. You revisit your experimental subjects over the course of years, kind of to have separate interviews with them and trace their development and so on. So she did the first longitudinal study on normal grieving. This year also marks a very important year. So this is now, we're in 1960s. Up until 1960s, mental disorders were classified, that DSM books 1 and 2 were kind of written under the guidance, under the assumption of Freudian psychoanalysis. So there were some theories about the mind and how the mind works and how psychopathology emerges that Freud postulated based on his own case studies. So a lot of the DSM-1 and 2 describes mental disorders in that kind of framework. One worry about that framework was that it wasn't scientific enough. It wasn't really relying on actual data that comes from patients. It doesn't rely on observations that we do on the patients, but rather we already have a theoretical framework and we list certain conditions as being, you know, indications of mental illness. So, and psychiatrists in the 1960s were getting uncomfortable with not being scientific enough. So she was one of those psychiatrists who said, I'm going to run a scientific study to understand grief, okay? So she was working at a hospital, and you know, at the hospital every day somebody is dying, so she had like the perfect group of people that she could study. She interviewed the family members of those who passed, who died in the hospital. So in her initial interview, these relatives gave kind of reports of having depressed mood or sleep disturbance or crying. And these kinds of symptoms were occurring, you know, more than half of the subjects. She goes back and interviews with them again in 2 to 4 months, and she found that 81% of the relatives actually they improved. So they weren't crying as much, or they weren't, you know, not sleeping as much. They were kind of adjusting the situation. But there was a kind of a ratio that actually just got worse. And those who have improved at the end of the study reported that their kind of this depressed mood, these states lasted about 6 to 10 weeks after the death, except for those kind of more complicated grief people, that they it took them a lot longer and they needed psychiatric assistance. But in this kind of normal group, people were back to being normal within 6 months, and about 98% of these people did not really need any kind of clinical assistance or psychiatric care and so on. They were able to cope with it by their own resources. So, but because we had that percentage of people who experienced complicated grief, who could not get better, psychiatrists said, we do have enough symptomology and, you know, medical study and research that shows maybe the justification of complicated grief being a separate mental disorder, you know, so that we can actually help these people who are unable to overcome their grief. And what was really interesting was the symptoms of this complicated grief phenomenon, including sadness, sleep disruptions, changes in appetite, fatigue, diminished interest or pleasure in previously enjoyed activities, difficulties in concentration. Do these resemble you of anything? What?
Depression.
Depression, right. That's what they said. Wow, they look complicated. Grief looks a lot like depression. And then again, the challenge was to distinguish cases in which experience of grieving individuals are within the range of appropriate response to loss from those complicated. And the main kind of factor has been found to be time. That is, kind of why they wanted to include this bereavement exclusion criterion to the third edition of the DSM-3. So we had something like, I'm just going to kind of go fast and show you this picture. So this is how now the DSM had evolved on grief. So the first two editions of the DSM, DSM 1 and 2, the ones that have been kind of shaped by psychoanalytic influences, has nothing on grief. It doesn't say anything on grief. In DSM 3, this is right after, this is published after Paula Clayton published her study of longitudinal grief. They added bereavement exclusion, meaning if the depression-like symptoms of the individual in grief exceeded 1 year, a depression diagnosis could be made, because within that 1 year, you were supposed to, grief was considered to be normal, okay? So in DSM-4, that 1 year lowered down to 2 months. So the normal period that in which you can grieve kind of reduced down from 1 year to 2 months, okay? And in finally, DSM 5, it was removed completely, meaning that what this phenomenon of what I call grief erosion happened, because initially, grieving for a year was normal, and then grieving for 2 months became normal, and then grieving became abnormal altogether. Does that make sense? That's why it's kind of grief erosion. It kind of eroded this psychological phenomenon that is so common in animals and humans kind of disappear. So, and the debate has largely focused on evidence. Well, we don't have any evidence that shows that depression actually is different from grief. And now kind of I will step back and talk about this evidence point. I'll go back to my former slides. So I want to kind of show you this diagram that I'm really proud of drawing. I love these like timelines. I love history. When I explain things in a historical perspective, it makes me feel better. So I don't feel as bad about Nazi medicine when I think of like, the nationalistic movements all around the world. So the same thing with the DSM. So let's understand how actually grief was eroded as a psychological phenomenon and became a mental illness. So this is Korean War. United States military had to decide who is fit to go to war, who's psychologically and physically fit. There wasn't any psychological test or criteria developed at the time that kind of determined one's fitness to ability to kind of be on the front line and fight. So they created this manual that listed that kind of, you know, gave us a set criteria for what is considered mentally fit and what is considered not mentally fit. Depending on that, we sent some soldiers to Korean War and some stayed at home based on their kind of psychological fitness. DSM-1 was largely a book that was based on that military guide. It was a statistical guide. So DSM-1 is that. That's 1952. That's when it was published. And because the main dominant way of understanding human psychology was psychoanalysis at the time, DSM-1 adopted a psychoanalytic framework in describing mental illness. So in 1960s, World Health Organization in Europe also started classifying mental disorders as separate conditions from physical disorders. So that was in 1960s. And what happened there was, but they weren't necessarily using a purely psychoanalytic guide, they were more kind of evidence and research based. What happened was, you know, something like schizophrenia had different symptoms according to ICD and different symptoms in the DSM-1. So they weren't really kind of overlapping. So one, I could be diagnosed with schizophrenia here, but if I go to Europe, I wouldn't be diagnosed with schizophrenia. So the result, the kind of the criteria wasn't reliable. That's what scientists call it. So in 1968, the second version of the DSM was published to address some of these anomalies and some problems. And that was also, remember, the year that Paula Clayton started doing her scientific study on grief. DSM-2 also did not satisfy scientifically minded psychiatrists because they wanted more evidence. So around this time, in 1940s and 50s, after we found penicillin, we were able to treat something like syphilis. And syphilis was a disease that had a lot of like mental expressions, you know, at the end stage of syphilis. People experienced like severe mental distress, but when antibiotics cure syphilis, there was this increased optimism that maybe we can cure other mental illnesses also with these drugs. So then the medical model of disease had become like spread. So that what's happening in the DSM was to respond to these events that was happening in the scientific world at the time, and then they published the DSM-3. So DSM-3 is radically different from the DSM-1 and 2 in that it lists mental disorders according to what scientists call external validators, so symptoms and signs. So sleeplessness, weight loss and gain are things that we can all observe. So that, you know, describing mental disorder in relation to those symptoms that we can all observe makes it more scientific and objective. Does that make sense? That was the move. So they were attempting to, in fact, turn this diagnostic criteria of mental disorders into sort of objective phenomenon. So the same mental, the same features of depression are the same across the world. So whether you're in England or in Utica, wouldn't matter. If you have those behaviors, then you would be diagnosed with the same illness. So one complication of this symptom-based approach, and this is something like, you know, let's kind of go back to our depression criteria again, right? When you are talking about depression, you're talking about these symptoms, being depressed, having a depressed mood, loss of interest and pleasure, and you know, all of these, like, you know, feeling of worthlessness, insomnia or hypersomnia. These are individual features. So we know that, you know, psychiatrists, clinicians know that this is a model of a person, but that, you know, the person's actually, the way in which they experience depression is quite variant. You know, Dr. Riddle and I might both be depressed, but the way we experience the depression might be radically different from each other. Maybe I will, you know, maybe I sleep a lot less and he sleeps a lot more, and his depressed mood may look like, may look different from my depressed mood. So, you know, by just looking at this diagnostic criteria, you can't really have, you don't really have much information about the very person who is going through that stress. So now thinking about those different dimensions of grief, right? You're grieving the loss of the other person, you're grieving the loss of a part of yourself, or you're grieving the loss of the relationship. None of those more personal feelings of grief, that experience, has a place in the DSM, because DSM wants to list everything into observable behavioral symptoms. Okay, so this phenomenon is called hyponarrativity. So there is very little narrative in symptoms, in symptom-based descriptions. So symptoms just list depressed mood, sleeplessness, kind of independent from the context. But when we look at kind of these descriptions of mental disorders, they look like they are primarily behavioral anomalies. So what exactly is making me sleepy or not able to sleep, unable to sleep? And like those are not really part of those DSM descriptions. They appear like they're atemporal events. So, you know, whether someone is depressed as a teenager versus as an adult might be actually really important for us to know to treat that person's depression. But DSM doesn't have kind of any room for that. It doesn't recognize that things might occur differently at different life stages in a person's life. They look like they just kind of emerged from nothing, so as if my sleeplessness just came out of nowhere, not because of you working a lot or whatever, those factors are not, those contextual factors are not considered. And they appear like these are things that happen to individual, like solitary individuals out there in the world. So if, if one doesn't really have a good social environment, they lost their parents, they don't have a lot of friends and so on, these are immediately related to mental health, yet they are not part of these DSM descriptions. So then, you know, as a result of these, we have like the first dimension of mental illness is missing in that DSM descriptions because it's primarily a behavioral criteria. And we have what I call historical narrative aspects of mental disorders are omitted. Like, they're not really part of the scientific schema. So these include individuals' particular life story. Again, are you an immigrant or not? That may have a lot to do with your depression. Do you speak English well or not? That might have a lot of influence in your mental health. Interpersonal relationship, are you by yourself? Are you in a relationship? Do you have friends? Biological and environmental risk factors, gender, race, class, status, dual offense, interjectual offense, disorder. All of these are very actually important. And in fact, if you go to the work, talk to a social worker, they will start thinking about the person that they're treating by taking these factors into account right away, yet the very manual that is supposed relevant experience of mental illness. But this was, you know, all because of DSM's efforts to be scientific, and then it resulted with this picture, because we are defining depression in terms of symptoms, and we are defining complicated grief in terms of symptoms. At first sight, it looks like they are the same phenomena. However, complicated grief is something that needs a different kind of treatment, perhaps, than depression treatment. And this is where I think that this is a justice issue, that those with complicated grief do not get the treatment that they need if their condition is diagnosed as depression as opposed to complicated grief. Okay? So how does justice principle relate to this? So, as I'm sure Dr. Riddle taught you, distributive justice principle is one of the most important medical ethics principles in medicine. And it's the principle that describes treating people fairly and according to what they deserve, especially in matters of public health, especially in situations of scarcity, right? So, and then that means justice in healthcare is usually defined as a form of fairness. And you know, Aristotle's words, it means giving to each that which is his due. So then this implies fair distribution of healthcare in society. So now I'm assuming that we are responsible for providing care and assistance and help to that person who experienced a serious loss and who is now experiencing complicated grief. I'm not talking about those who were able to cope with it. I'm talking about that, you know, little percent group who still had kind of reminiscence of the grief and they just can't get back to their life. We as a society are responsible to address their healthcare needs. And this is in fact one of the motivations for listing complicated grief as possibly being diagnosed with depression. So that's the very motivation that the DSM-5 had. But I'm arguing that diagnosing complicated grief with depression violates the justice principle, because DSM-5, by slotting grief under depression, loses the kind of therapeutic importance of distinguishing the two. So it doesn't actively guide the clinician to engage with the personal details of individuals' particular loss. Because, you know, remember what Freud said, you need to replace that energy invested in the other person with something else. So ideally, in this treatment kind of case scenario, the clinician should be responsible for really understanding the meaning and significance of this particular relationship for this person, maybe offer some strategies to coping with that loss, encourage the patient, and so on. But if we are looking primarily at the symptomology, how are we going to actually engage with those personal details? And interestingly, that's the other interesting phenomenon, I think, in mental health care in contemporary society. There is this manual and the scientific guide that psychiatrists create, but then there are clinicians, like social workers, psychologists, or psychiatrists, who deal with actual patients. And when you look at the way in which complicated grief or grief is treated in those contexts, that they, you know, encourage psychotherapeutic approaches by targeting the person, the self, directly. So I will kind of read you a number of treatment strategies. So, for instance, there are some psychologists and clinicians who believe in the importance of addressing the self-related aspect of grief. So, for instance, they take into account age, race, and gender of the griever. These are important determinants for psychotherapeutic treatments. You know, if you're dealing with small children and loss, you might have to adjust your treatment plan according to that. And they do that. There are clinicians, psychologists, who do adopt these approaches, dealing with helping these patients. They also focus on other related or relationship-related aspects of grief. For instance, they encourage people to cognitively restructure the relationship and kind of force themselves to deal with them. So, you know, let's say you love your, you know, father, but they also were violent to you. So you kind of, you're being helped by the clinician to kind of expose yourself to the reality of the relationship with your father and kind of try to restructure your experience while you're also grieving. So there are different methodologies that they use to address these. So for instance, there are cognitive restructuring techniques that help the grieving person come to terms with the death of the deceased, for instance, following suicide, and to revise like their understanding of him. So if you think that your mother is your hero and that she commits suicide, that might just kind of require some adjustment in the way that you restructure or think about that relationship and its importance to you. And there are also exposure techniques. These typically involve retelling the story of the loss, how exactly, for instance, did the person die, or confronting the avoidance of place or people associated with the loss, and the interventions target both the experience of loss and the restorative processes. So, okay, now that that best friend is gone, Montaigne, right, where people's really sad that his best friend died, you know, well, how can we help Montaigne build similar good quality relationships and so on? So, and all this is to say that while some of these treatment strategies, like goal setting, are also used in depression, in treating depression, methods such as exposure and restructuring are used exclusively to treat patients who encounter grief or traumatic event. So even though they may carry the same features, grief and depression carry the same features, treatment methods that are used for complicated grief are in fact different from treatment methods that are used for depression, because these two conditions have different causal histories and different characteristics. So it's not right for the DSM to assume that just because the symptoms resemble each other, that the same treatment strategies will work. And this is a problem because remember that the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders is not just a research guide, but it's also a guide for a clinician. One of my biggest concerns, and because I teach a lot of healthcare students, I have a lot of physician assistant, nursing, and physical therapy students, is this one. So the DSMs are used for teaching purposes in medical schools, and the more symptom-oriented the mental descriptions are, the more we just look at the symptoms, then we don't teach those students to look at the full person that they are trying to treat, right? And that's a very, very important step for the clinician to become a better clinician, to actually learn to understand the patient as a whole and kind of contextualize and interpret their lives. But if you're using this very manual in educating those students and assuming that, you know, there are lots of students in the class and it's hard for each student to pay attention to each detail and they're perpetually stressed out about anatomy exams and so on, that it's kind of, you know, misleading to just teach students to manage symptoms or manage grief or treat grief by just looking at symptoms. So then, in a manual that aims to improve the clinical practice in psychiatry, then there must be kind of a guide, there must be, these clinical interests must be prioritized. So in other words, kind of to conclude my talk, perhaps what we kind of learn from the example of grief and in its history is that perhaps the main kind of problem is that we put all of our eggs in the same basket. What do I mean by that? We create this one book, one manual, and we think that it will be helpful and useful for all these variety of purposes, right? For clinic, for research, for insurance, for communication, for administrative purposes. If you try to do too many things, you end up with this kind of poor guide for clinical purposes. And that's it.
Thank you very much. So I will attempt to spot hand.
and we just we only have impression.
So I guess I have a two-part question. The first part is I've always been disappointed with BSM concerns with insurance. Like, it's kind of a reality that psychologists need to get paid, and it's kind of a reality that you live in a country where insurance is such a big issue and difficulty with payment. It, from the very beginning, it has always seemed that that has sort of clouded the water with issues of, giving the digital number code so that you can get paid. And I wish that the APA would just stop that, even though that's a reality, because it messes the whole scientific, stuff. The other issue is like this grand issue about agency in psychopathology and perhaps over-medicalizing all of psychopathology in terms of, you have depression instead of you are a depressed person. And with psychopharmacology, then it's easy to just throw something at that. I think the combination of the over-reliance on the insurance code and this taking agency out. So complicated grief seems to be a way that we can say you should have agency over this. Whereas depression, you have depression, it's out of your control. Do you think that that's part of the particular aspect of a personal agency is complicated?
I absolutely agree with both of the points that you raised. I mean, that kind of perfect storm slide, that's one of my worries. So when you tie insurance or health coverage into this manual, and by the way, the American Psychiatric Association makes a lot of money from the DSM sales. Like, it's the source of revenue because all medical students or students in medical fields need to buy that book. And there's always a perpetual missing copy in your library. So they sell, that's a big source of revenue, and that's a conflict of interest. And the other, I think that's like what, there's this like vicious cycle. Now psychiatrists say, well, if your psychologist might say, well, if it doesn't have a code, then I won't get reimbursed, or that the medications that I prescribe won't be covered. It's just vicious, this vicious cycle. So I agree with that, and that's, the other part is one thing that I didn't say when the medical model of disease emerged. There were also lots of money that were being made by pharmaceutical companies. And this idea that there is one symptom that could be treated with this one drug is extremely attractive. Because working on the agent or the self or the person is a lot more difficult, right? The person has to be willing to. They have to be open to kind of have an understanding that they have an agency. Because the one thing that happens, I think, as a result of over-diagnosis or over-medicalization is that we are creating very weak individuals. Because we immediately want to match that sleeplessness with that kind of medication as opposed to encouraging the patient to kind of take a look at the stock of their life, look at it as a whole.
And it's a lot more expensive.
Exactly. It is a lot more expensive. And that's like, you really kind of got to the heart of my book manuscript. That's kind of my argument. If you want to talk about mental disorder, scientifically or even from an ethical or clinical perspective, you need to make the agent or the self or the person the center of analysis, because these symptoms will always kind of work. Now the National Institute of Mental Health, they are not satisfied with the DSM, but they want to go in the direction of like the neurons and neural pathways and so on, and that has a lot of risks and dangers as well, because that's also sidestepping the agent or the self.
Right. Yeah. It does the same thing as, I've got my training as a psychobiologist, and it's I'm assuming it's in the brain, but there's also a person there.
Exactly.
As well, so.
Yeah. And brain is not really static, or not responsive.
suggestions, and I'm curious if you want to make both suggestions or one more than the other. So one suggestion is recognizing the role that the DSM plays within the psychiatric community. We should change how the DSM operates. Like, it's got this specific role, people coordinate around its use, they give it a certain kind of respect and authority, thus we should be more careful about what's in the DSM and what it says. A second suggestion is, the DSM is gonna be this type of thing. It's gonna be systematic, symptom-focused, and because it's that type of thing, those who practice in the field should be hesitant about giving it so much authority as they do. They should be more careful, they should look towards other things, other resources besides the DSM. And so one suggestion is to say we should change the DSM and value the role that it plays within the field, and the other is to say we should change the way in which we view the role of the DSM within the field. Is there one of those that...
Well, actually, these are kind of, I'm on board with both of them,
okay,
in that I think that two things need to happen, and I think if one happens, the other will happen. So if we stop putting all of these different functions, like, we're treating DSM as Swiss Army knife, like, great for all these purposes, but it's not. So either kind of say, this is just for clinical, this is just for communication, whatever, and here are the other resources that you must look at as a clinician. But that needs to be turn into a policy of some sort too, because the DSM has the power that it has because of policy. That's why I think it's very important to talk about justice and kind of distribution in this sense, because it's all about policy. So what we can do is we can kind of change the policy in a way that takes the power away from the DSM, but also by kind of offering the supplemental guides. Like, you know, in all other areas of science, for instance, they use different models for different purposes. There's nothing more natural than creating different constructs depending on our purposes. In the clinic, a person-centered model might be helpful, but if I really, really want to just use symptoms, I can kind of do these stem cell experiments in dishes by kind of taking this, you know, brain cells from people with these symptoms. So I guess like both, yeah. But I like the way you put the first one better. Person who will be able to understand life. Because a lot of immigrants, for instance, get mental disorder diagnosed, and I'm never sure how well they're treated, because a lot of the muscle cross-cultural issues, and it might be difficult for both the clinician and the patient to actually find a common language in which therapeutic improvement can be made.
I'm wondering if we can conceptualize the principle of distributive justice in a manner such that it's not violated by this. And the way that I'm thinking about that is, I take it to be the case that the principle of distributive justice does at least two things. It articulates what justice is, figures out what the currency of justice is, and it attempts to identify injustice. So it seems to me that the push to combine these sorts of things suggests that the disadvantage that suffered as a result of experiencing both of these things is quite similar as we saw with the symptoms. So therefore, the affront to justice can be identified similarly. And it strikes me as being the case that a principle of justice that identifies disadvantage similarly does not have to commit itself to treating that disadvantage identically.
And that's exactly the problem. So I could be giving the same talk, replacing grief with depression. So I don't think that this diagnostic criteria is necessarily great at addressing depression either. But you're absolutely right. So they can be said in the work way, but the treatment has to be equitable rather than identical.
Might not be a violation.
Under the breast. so then you know where you can call how to look at it, and you have to really manage and do it in the system. Otherwise, I use the same before. So. But that's a great question.
Do you think you're going to work on it in the future?
Yeah, I might. I have been trying to get to more policy, hands-on issues, but I just have so much to say about these more theoretical parts, but yeah, that's very
Would you be able to, or would you be interested in lobbying for change to the DSM in general to account for these differences? And if so, how would you go about doing it specifically?
Yes. The last couple of years have been quite exciting. Me and another philosopher of psychiatry, I was a postdoctoral research fellow at the University of Pittsburgh, and she was a graduate student at the time. So we organize a philosophy of psychiatry conference because these matters are now being discussed more and more among philosophers, and I think philosophers are very well situated to do this kind of work because we can understand the science, we can understand the policy, but we also have a kind of conceptual framework in order to compare and critically think about things. So we hosted a conference at University of Pittsburgh that featured the work of junior scholars in philosophy of psychiatry. We got emails from the directors of National Institute of Mental Health. They wanted to see the publications that would come out of the conference and so on. So I saw that as a kind of step where psychiatrists or clinicians are taking a step to understand and communicate some of these concerns. The other group that I'm a member of is the Association for the Advancement of Philosophy and Psychiatry. It brings philosophers and psychiatrists, critical mind psychiatrists together. And we have annual conferences, and we have a news bulletin, and so on. And a lot of great work happens in those conversations. And we hold our meeting at the American at the same time and at the same place as the American Psychiatric Association. So we often would have this critical psychiatrist person being very suspicious and coming into a talk, looking at us like what we're talking and so on. So I think that's the key. I think I definitely see myself or my work relevant to what psychiatrists do, and I don't know how much power that I, as an individual philosopher, could have at the higher levels, but I do get contacted by psychiatrists or psychiatric residents or sometimes patients themselves. I feel like there's something happening that people are receiving or seeing this. So I'm an optimist by nature, so I want to be hopeful and hope that we can actually generate some change.
I would suggest you look at Nancy Hogan's work.
Okay.
She does work with grief, and she has an article in 2013. I can send that to you if you'd like. She's done some great work with, she's differentiating the standard model for grief, which most of the measures of grief that psychologists use are psychopathological. And she has some great data suggest that there's a very strong component with grief, as opposed to depression, that has a component of personal growth.
Oh, really?
So most people who go through grief will report, factor analysis kind of thing that involves personal growth when they come out of grief, which you typically don't see with depression. Mm-hmm. So she's at University of Florida, or Florida State, Nancy Hogan, 2013. It's really, and that particular article was the development of her scale. And she said, all of the scales of grief focus on the pathological nature of grief, which overlaps mostly with depression. But I think that might be a good source to argue the differentiation because you can have a runny nose because you've got allergies and a cold and the symptom approach. And so this is a differential diagnosis that includes personal growth.
That's fantastic.
It's really great.
Yeah, and it builds resilience.
Yeah.
Anyone else like to take the opportunity to ask a question? Comments?
I have a question about
from the day in life that we have in the United States, sort of perpetually running around, trying to make money, having multiple jobs, going to school, etc., waking up really early, and so on, whereas in more libertarian cultures, there's more kind of this like joy of daily life and whatnot. And people really get together around times of grief and loss and cook for the person and their family. There's a lot of crying that happens, just like lots of crying, lots of sharing. It lasts for a long time. And I think it's really healthy, like in a certain way, because you have time to kind of digest everything. And part of the reason that I call it grief erosion is that initially 1 year is normal and now 2 months is normal. And I think that has a lot to do with the pressures of the external world. Like I can go back to work, and you can take your leave, but I'll take leave, so do you want to really do that, and so on. So I think there are some, you know, life possibilities where these are kind of experienced in a more, it's a part of like normal life. Sorry about that. I'm a philosopher, I get to get away with it.
Any other comments or questions? No, please join me in that.